Good afternoon. I'm Lauren Swartz. I'm a member of the Easton Film Festival Committee, and tonight I'm your hostess for our program. And the Easton Film Festival is a community-run group of people. We organize three different areas of film interest in town. You can find our Forum Film series playing every other week at Andrew's Bakery, which is across the street from the Stonehill College entrance. The schedule of the Forum Films are posted around town as well as on the program schedule that runs on this channel. We also have an ongoing film competition that begins in the springtime for our festival. We've run it 2 years now. And the third aspect of our organization is this cable show, of which plays Mondays and Tuesdays on Channel 9 at 7 o'clock. So I hope you're joining us every week, meeting some of our local filmmakers, as well as commentary on the foreign films that are run at Andrew's Bakery. Our entire organization is sponsored by the Northeastern Savings Bank, of which we thank them so much for their support, ongoing support throughout the year. Today we are joined by two local filmmakers, Buddy Wooster and Bob Holmes, who produced a film this past year in our competition entitled The Langwater Story. So I welcome you gentlemen to our show.
Welcome.
And like to first tell me about the film and tell our audience how it is that you came to make The Langwater Story. Buddy.
Well, we came to make The Langwater Story because we have seen, especially myself, so much disappearing farmland and open space in not too many, over a period of not too many years.
Mm-hmm.
And so we found that much of the land that was part of Langwater Farm is still visible and remains. It's either Stonehill Campus or part of the Ames Estate, the Langwater buildings, the barns, and so forth. We're all there to be shown. And of course, it's a nationally famous farm, in fact, world famous.
Right.
And for that reason, we got interested in, we thought we'd be able to get information, since we have a local historical society.
And right.
Of course, the Ameses are still there. And one of the first steps we took, I did write a letter to Oliver Ames, who remembers the farm very well, and he started us on our journey of research.
Very good. So how long did that journey take you?
We started in January.
Okay.
And we finished just before the deadline for the Easton Film Festival.
Which was in May, correct?
Which was in May.
Okay.
So Rob, of course, is the video man, and one of the reasons I thought of doing it at all was because he had done an amateur video of our family, and I thought he did it rather well. So with that hope, we began our journey.
Okay, very good. Mm-hmm. And so tell me how you came to be involved, Bob.
Well, like I said, Buddy knew that I at least had some technical experience as far as being able to put movies together, so he'd been pestering me actually the year before, the first year of the Easton Film Festival, to get a project going. And of course, I said, well, I'm too busy. And finally, he got me moving on the project the second year. And we looked around and thought, well, you know, because of the criteria, it had to be based in Easton.
Right.
And, you know, what would be the easiest or, you know, for a first-time project to delve into? And we thought, well, you know, Buddy had worked for Langwater Farm for, I think, a summer during his high school years. And so he said, well, there was a farm down there. And so we went and looked around. I thought it was just going to be one little farm. And lo and behold, it was three or four different properties extending, you know, various areas. And it was quite extensive. And it turned out to be quite a large project, actually.
I was
trying to keep it under the 20-minute guideline, but after the materials and all the information we acquired, it was impossible at that point. So
okay.
We wanted to do it right too. So
right. Do you recall how much footage, how many hours you ended up shooting to raw footage?
Oh, I interviewed three or four different people and probably used, you know, maybe 15 minutes of it.
Okay.
But it was quite a bit of, I would say 3 or 4 hours worth that they cut down to 50 minutes. And like I said, this particular farm had so many different facets to it. I tried to cram in as much as I could during the film, but it was still, I think we were still scratching the surface.
Oh, I'm sure.
It was quite a wonderful run farm as far as, you know, the Ameses kept it in tip-top shape and really did a wonderful job running it. And like I said, their animals were just unbelievable.
Right. That's great. When you started out, Buddy, the main idea, what were you looking to accomplish with the project?
Well, I was really looking to do a documentary, a historical, give it a historical view of this really very famous farm.
Okay.
And the more we researched it, the farther we went, it became even greater than I remembered it. I mean, we went out to Iowa State, we went up to Galesville, Wisconsin. We didn't go there, but we called, we talked to the people. The Clydesdales of Anheuser-Busch were brought into the film. The prize-winning cattle, the beginning of the Guernsey herd, everything began to, you know, really reveal itself of a far greater magnitude than we had anticipated. So we became more and more interested, and as we became more interested, we were very fortunate in having contact with people who grew up at Langwater.
Very good.
And the father of one of the people with whom we spoke was Clifford Shaw, who ran Langwater for 27 years.
Okay.
So they provided us with an enormous number of photographs, information, and they had great enthusiasm. They really, you know, jumped right into this and said, "How can we help you?" And that was true of about everyone we talked to. They were so willing to contribute, and they got excited about it, and of course that gave us the impetus to keep moving and moving. So,
it sounds like you were surprised at the amount of material that seemed to come out of the woodwork.
We were, and, and even as we looked at Langwater on Main Street and the estate there, and realized, of course, that it encompassed earlier the old Langwater, what was became Stonehill College, and the buildings themselves, even the landscaping, of course, a lot of it we get into was the Olmsted landscaping,
sure.
And you really could never be sure where that natural left off and the other began, and you know, all of these things really intrigued us and sort of enhanced the feeling we had about this, and as I say, it became more interesting and bigger than we anticipated.
Right. So how were you able to wean out, you know, the prime, I guess, the juicy pieces for the film? I mean, how did you do it?
Well, basically, just Rob can answer this better than I, but basically we felt even after 50 minutes rather than the 20 that we could have gone on and on, but we just selected, you know, these were the people that contributed so much to our knowledge, so we wanted them in it, the ones we interviewed. And so we stayed pretty much with that.
Very good. Well, I think you brought the film along with you for those people who weren't able to see it at the competition in the spring. Mm-hmm. So I think we have a bit of film to go to for our audience to see. So let's take a look at a clip that you brought with you.
Pastures of the number one Guernsey herd in the country. This is the story of the men responsible for this farm and its achievement. The sons of Frederick Lothrop Ames, F. Lothrop Ames, and John S. Ames were extraordinary men from an extraordinary family. The people who managed and worked in this remarkable farm were dedicated, loyal, and knowledgeable. This is their story too.
Broken like the first morning. bird has spoken like the first bird. Praise for the singing, praise for the morning, praise for them springing fresh from the world. Sweet the rain's new fall, sunlit from heaven, like the first dew fall on the first grass. Praise for the sweetness of the wet garden, sprung in completeness where his feet pass. Mine is the sunlight, mine is the morning, born of the one light, Eden's or play. Praise with elation, praise every morning, God's recreation of the new.
The stone mansion, built in 1859 by Frederick Lothrop Ames, along with the beautiful stone stable in the Gate Lodge, built in 1881, give an air of permanency to Langwater Estate. Evidence of Olmsted landscaping abounds, especially noticed in the attractive stone bridge that spans Langwater Pond and connects two Ames properties. Slightly west of the bridge, the Quiset River flows into the pond it created when James Leonard built the first dam that crosses Main Street sometime between 1713 and 1721. The pond was first named Stone's Pond after Gurdon Stone, whose house still stands at 228 Main Street. Frederick Lothrop Ames renamed the pond Langwater, Scottish, or Along the Water. The property at Langwater can be entered by the Gate Lodge, 133 Elm Street. This H.H. Richardson building is considered by some to be the finest example of the famous architect's buildings in Easton. Glacial boulders from a nearby meadow were used in its construction. It is especially interesting because of the detail of its dormer eyelids, a means of preserving the sweep of the roof. South and east of the mansion are the pastures where Frederick Lothrop Ames first placed his Guernsey cattle. Much of the land that comprised Langwater Farms remains today as open space. Some remaining buildings mark the landscape. Among them are the farmhouse at 250 Main Street, a large hay barn built in 1900 to replace the original barn which burned. Behind the farmhouse is a small barn which housed cattle in need of a vet's care. Further along the drive is a red stucco stable, which was home for the draft horses. Beyond the stable is a carpenter shop. Foundations of the silos, dairy barns, milk room, and tester's room are visible as footprints only. Still a part of the farm landscape are the stone walls that surround fields on three sides. Other stone walls divide what was once pasture. Large gate openings on either side of Main Street are reminders of the route of the cattle from one pasture to another and return to the dairy barn. In fields to the east, separated from 138 by stone wall, are signs of abandoned orchards. The foundation of the bull barn, which once housed the prized sires of the herd, is yet visible. Old Langwater, Stonehill House, a mansion built by F. Lothrop Ames in 1905 when he was 29 years old, once overlooked 600 acres of farmland made famous by Langwater Guernsey. This mansion and this land, now Stonehill College campus, still has some remaining farm buildings, silo, cattle barns, and fencing, which, although altered to different purpose, are still recognizable for what they were. The imposing stone gate entrance off 138, across from the southeastern cemetery, brings us to the previously described scene. Across the road is the clock barn with its ship's clock in the tower, its horse-shaped weather vane, and horseshoe-marked pennants. This barn was built in 1908 by Lothrop Ames for his horses, Clydesdales and Irish jumpers. It later served as a cattle barn for Guernseys. Its fields marked and divided by stone walls and bordered to the west by pines and hardwood trees look very much as they did those many years ago. South of the clock barn is another small shingled barn, which served as hospital to sick livestock. In 1978, David Ames Sr. presented this property as a gift to Stonehill College. The Marshall Farm, another large barn with farmland acreage to match, remains off Elm Street, south and west of Monty's Pond. The Dorchester Brook divides its main fields. The barn housed heifers and young bulls of the Langwater herd. In 1914, Lothrop Ames purchased James Rankin's Maplewood Farm, now the Easton Country Club, as a home for his championship Clydesdale. It was Mr. Ames's Fairholme footprint that became famous in the history of the Clydesdales, and whose bloodlines can be traced back from the famous Budweiser Clydesdales. Hopefully, this background sketch will prepare the way for a return to the Langwater story.
Well, now I want the rest of the film to go on. But anyway, we saw some clips here, and we were talking while the film was playing, and you were telling me some of the methods and the research that you were did to put this film together. Remind me again the distances that you went, the various resources that you utilized in researching out of state, for the various, for the livestock, the buildings. Share with me that.
Well, the a large source, in fact, the best source for the story of Fairholme Footprint, the very famous Clydesdale, we had to go to Iowa State University, which is in Ames, Iowa, because that is where the horse was, actually was donated by Lothrop's widow.
Okay, Ames, Iowa is named after the Ames family.
Yes.
Thank you.
And from there, this Becky Jordan, who was the archivist out there, sent us to Budweiser, and Betty Groves, the secretary of the Clydesdale News, I guess you'd call it, and Jim Emmons, also associated in the out in Galesburg, Wisconsin, I should say. He is the historian. And in the 2003 edition of the Clydesdale News, a beautiful book, by the way, there's a very lengthy article of the history of the Clydesdales. And going back to 1916, 1917, and 19, I believe, when Fairholme Footprint won the Grand National Exposition, he's included in that, and all the get, as they say, and those were very, very famous offspring of that very famous horse. So that took us farther afield
than this. Wow, I mean, I don't think people understand sometimes the scope of the and the history involved of the entire country that's right here in Easton.
That's right.
So it is fascinating watching the film.
Well, I'm glad you mentioned that because in the conclusion of the video, there is the acknowledgement that, you know, here is all this that sprung from this little tiny village. And it did.
It is incredible. Mm-hmm. Again, when we were watching the film, you were sharing with me some of the production challenges. We weren't able to have a nice spring day for you to film because you needed all this time for the production. Right. Share with me some of the challenges that you had to do, that you had to go through.
Well, the majority, we couldn't obviously film open fields during the winter because that wouldn't look any good.
Right.
So we had to wait, and this past spring happened to be one of the rainiest springs on record.
Yes, it was.
And we just happened to caught one day that was, the sun came out and it just was just beautiful and it hit the buildings just right, angles and whatnot as far as the technical aspect of it. And we just went out there and I took the day off from work and we went out there and we spent a good, I don't know, six, 8 hours just filming the different buildings and getting all that out of the way.
And you were the sole cameraman.
It was the sole cameraman. And
and you also were not using one of the very fancy Hollywood cameras that has like it's called a Steadicam.
Right, no, I just basically used a little, Sony camcorder, analog, not even a digital camcorder, and just did it freehand.
Because the footage is absolutely beautiful. You would have thought it was planned for, or you had Hollywood set designers kind of sprucing up the spring or whatever.
No, we just shot it from the hip and did the best we could, really.
That's great.
He's very
patient. He's very patient and very meticulous.
Right. I think a lot of these shots do take time. You also, as you said, interspersed a lot of old photos in the run of the film so that we could see modern day.
Right. I did a lot of fade-ins where you would be looking at what a building would look currently, and then I would fade into a old photograph. The Historical Society in Easton has tons and tons of old photos of the farm and what it used to look like. And so hopefully the film, I basically went from what it looks now, kept going back and back and back to the past.
Many of the structures that are in Easton have not changed much in the 100 or so years.
No, there's a lot of them are still
right. They're still there.
Still standing.
Right.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Obviously, the most changed area, I would say, and Buddy would probably agree with me, is Stonehill. Obviously,
right.
Where they've got a couple mm-hmm. old fences that look like old farm mm-hmm. fences, but for the most part, the whole landscape of the farm has been changed.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So that was probably the hardest to recreate is the Stonehill area.
You had to take it in little pieces rather than, big shots and
sure.
so forth. But and even there, if there were so many other things that had been there, you could see cellar holes and so forth, which we didn't do.
Right.
But the evidence was, the footprint was there,
Sure.
And that made it interesting, too.
Okay. And so then you move into production, and you have hours and hours and hours to cull down and also narration to write. Was it a scripted narration? Did you, some of it off the cuff? Because your voice, one, is very beautiful to listen to on the voiceovers, and two, sounds like you have been narrating Easton history forever. How did all of that come about?
Well, I wrote the prologue and the epilogue and some of the narration in between. That was my writing,
okay.
A sense of it. And then most of the factual information came from the Langwater story or from the Clydesdale information that we had. In other words, I couldn't make up a fact, so we had to use a fact. That was not obviously original. But
right.
To put it together, yes, we tried to make it as fluid as we could, let's put it that way.
Sure.
But,
sure.
And that was it.
And how many, the filming took weeks, months? How long did you actually film the footage that we saw? How long did it take you?
No, that was actually what you saw on the camera there was really just done in one day. Was that one
just
day?
One
that
day.
Was the one day that, like I said, the sun finally came out after about 2 weeks of straight rain.
Right.
As far as the actual name of the film is a return to Langwater Story, because I think a lot of our factual information came from that. It showed it there on the film, is that that Brown bound Langwater Story, which was a publication done while the farm was still in business back in the 1950s.
That was actually, that first appeared, most of that information, in the Guernsey Association article, because as a tribute to the family. This is when the farm was, the final sale was made in 1960.
Okay.
And those booklets were reprints, most of them given, obviously, to the people who worked there.
Okay.
Some of whom we interviewed and from whom we got some information. But that was our main source, there's no question about it. But the main, one of the big sources of photographs, in addition to the Historical Society, was a collection of Lydia Shaw Brower and Jane Shaw Smoot, the daughters of F. Clifford Shaw, who ran the farm for so many years. They sent us a wealth of photographs, they really did.
Oh,
and Rob has all of those, so he can tell you what he did with those.
And right? Also, not to interrupt, buddy, but Lydia and
Jane,
yeah, I'm sorry. Jane also supplied us with a film from 1938.
Yeah,
yeah, of the actual cows. And right. there is I use little clips of, you know, she just sent it up. It was, I don't know what type of camera she was using.
It was probably an old 16 millimeter, and then that was transferred to the video. She sent us two copies of those.
How fortunate for you to have found this.
That was, when we ever saw that videotape, that was unreal.
And did you, when it was over, you had no idea that it was going to snowball into the research, the film, the photographs, the people coming forward? You could not have.
No, it was quite special.
Very.
I think we both enjoyed it thoroughly.
Just in some final words, anything that you regret you didn't put in the film?
I don't regret anything we didn't put in. I wish we could have put more in, but I mean, I don't think we left anything out that would take precedence over what we put in. I mean, we really tried to be as selective as possible and to keep the story moving, so. It's a tough question, but that's the best that we can answer.
Well, I thank you, gentlemen, very much for joining
you.
Us. It was a pleasure to talk with you both, to watch a bit of your film. Thank you for sharing it with the town of Easton. I hope it's around to educate the children and all those else who are interested in the Historical Society.
Ed Hans, high school history teacher, I guess he's in charge of the history department in high school.
Mm-hmm.
He's bought a couple of copies of the film, and so I think it's going to be part of his curriculum for the.
Oh, that's great.
For his History of Easton classes. So.
That's great.
Right.
So, yeah, the kids in Easton will see this.
Good. Well, I'm glad to hear that. I have two children in the system, and so I'd be happy to know that they're learning that as well.
Mm-hmm.
So I thank you, gentlemen, very much. We have an entry coming up for this year. You have some ideas on the cooker for this upcoming film festival?
That's a good question.
Yeah.
We're still mulling over that
keep that a secret, right?
Okay, yes, keep it a secret. It is a competition, after all.
Yeah.
Right.
So.
If I could mention just a few other sources briefly. Ed Hans' Neighborhoods supplied us with some material, of course.
Okay.
And the Volume 2, The History of Easton, there was an article in there by David Ames Sr. About the Ames family.
Okay.
And that was very helpful to us also.
Oh, well, great. Thank you, gentlemen, both so much.
Thank
it's a
you.
Pleasure to meet you and talk with you. On behalf of the Easton Film Festival, I want to thank you. Thank our audience for joining us. I hope it spurs some interest in the future film entries. My name is Lauren Swartz. I'm a member of the Easton Film Festival committee, and I thank you all for joining us.
Good job.